Okay, good afternoon all. From last lecture, we are discussing or our discussion is related to the topic non-ferrous alloys. In that, we have completed the copper and copper alloys. Now, in this lecture, we will start the aluminium and aluminium alloys. Okay. In previous lectures, we have discussed about the copper alloys. In that, we have discussed related to brasses, then its different types depending on its microstructure. And then after completing the brasses related to their composition properties and application, we have discussed related to the bronzes. In that, we have discussed about the beryllium bronze. Then I think we have completed the silicon bronze, beryllium bronze, then tin bronze, and aluminium bronze. These four types we have completed. Now in this lecture, we will discuss related to the aluminium and its alloys. Okay. Now before starting the actual aluminium alloys, first we will discuss related to the what are the basic or unique properties that aluminium metal will provide, and that properties will be there in its respective alloys also. Now in that, the first property, as you can read it from the slide itself, that is the aluminium is soft, malleable and ductile in nature. This is very important property, so that we can give that aluminium or its different alloys, we can give them the desired shape and size by performing the different operations on it. Now here, in case of aluminium alloys, we can use hot working as well as cold working operations to give the desired shape and size to that particular alloy. And already we have discussed that as in the same way that the copper is also soft, malleable and ductile in nature. Now this ductility or malleability property is due to their FCC, face centered cubic structure. For both copper and alloy, they are having FCC crystal structure. Due to this FCC crystal structure only, these aluminium and copper and their alloys will provide you the very good ductility and malleability. Okay. And after this, aluminium and its alloys will be very light in weight. These are very light in weight. And along with the lighter weight, they will provide you, or they are having the means they will provide you very good conductivity for the for heat and electricity. Okay. And if you compare the aluminium and copper, means on weight to weight basis, it carries more electricity as compared to the copper. Okay. This is the very good distinguishing point between the aluminium and copper. Why aluminium is having significance use as far as your electricity is concerned for particular applications, because on weight basis, it can carry more amount of electricity as compared to the copper. That's why larger applications of aluminium, or aluminium is more widely used rather than using the copper. Then aluminium is having very good ability to get alloyed with the different alloying elements, means it will form the different alloys with the different alloying elements. Like suppose a silicon, you can add silicon in it, means aluminium silicon alloys, then aluminium copper alloys, then aluminium silicon copper alloys will be there, then aluminium magnesium alloys will be there. Like this, you can add the different alloying elements, and aluminium is having the property that it will easily get alloyed with the different alloying elements, and it will adopt with the desired properties required. Then this aluminium and its alloys will have, this is the unique property, that is they will provide you very good resistance to the corrosion as well as oxidation. Now why these aluminium and its alloys will provide you very good corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance? Because now they will form a thin layer of aluminium oxide. This aluminium oxide is nothing but this Al2O3. Due to formation of this layer, one protective layer will get formed on the surface of that particular metal. Okay, the thin layer will be formed of this aluminium oxide, that is Al2O3, and due to this, it will provide you better corrosion resistance as well as better oxidation resistance. And whichever layer this layer is formed, that is the aluminium oxide layer, it is non-toxic in nature. That's why we are using this in the aluminium films are used in the food packaging purpose. Okay. Whichever film is formed here, that is not the film will be non-toxic in nature. This is film of the aluminium oxide, or you can say that the alumina film is there, and it is non-toxic in nature. That's why it will provide you better corrosion resistance, better oxidation resistance, and you can use this in the food packaging purpose, as whichever layer is formed, that will be non-toxic in nature. And next property of the aluminium and its respective alloys, it is having very low ductile brittle transition temperature. Okay, then first question will be here, there is what is the meaning of ductile brittle transition temperature? Already I have explained this in the previous lectures, I will repeat it. Whichever ductile materials are there, they will change their properties from ductile to brittle, means transition will occur in their properties due to, or you can say that due to decrease in the temperature, or you can simply say that at lower temperature values up to minus 40. Now here you can say that for the aluminium alloys up to minus 40 degree Celsius, or you can say its ductile brittle transition temperature is minus 40 degree Celsius. At that lower temperature, it will transform from ductile material to the brittle material. This transition temperature will be termed as the ductile brittle transition temperature. And for aluminium and its alloys, its ductile brittle transition temperature is very low, up to minus 40 degree Celsius. That's why you can find its use in the different applications, in the means you can say that in the refrigeration in industry, or in the cryogenic services for the storage of the gases having, means the liquid hydrogen or liquid oxygen, you can store at a very low temperature. For storing them, you can use these alloys. Okay, aluminium alloys can be used, as these are having very low ductile brittle transition temperatures. Then these aluminium and its alloys, these are non-magnetic in nature and non-sparking in nature. Non-sparking in the sense, you can say that if you performed one simple grinding operation on any aluminium or its alloy material, then no spark will be generated here. Okay, now in our syllabus also we are having one practical, that spark test practical will be there, means in that practical we will be provided with one, you can say that one steel component, one cast iron component, then one copper alloy, one aluminium alloy, and you have to observe the nature of the spark. Now in that non-ferrous alloys, whichever non-ferrous alloys are there, like copper, or you can say that aluminium alloys, lead alloys, these non-ferrous alloys, they will not produce any kind of the spark, means they will be non-sparking in the nature. Non-sparking in the nature, and why this spark is not generated, all these things that we will discuss in that actual practical. In that practical we are going to conduct, in that we are just going to perform one simple grinding operation on it, and we are going to observe the pattern, whichever spark pattern will be there, that pattern you have to observe. And simply here you can remember it, that for copper alloys or different aluminium alloys, no spark will be there. That's why it is termed as non-sparking in nature. Then it has a low neutron absorption coefficient, means its neutrons will absorb lesser energy here, and it is having very high reflectivity for the heat and other forms of the energy. Then it will act as a deoxidizer, and this part we have studied in the type of the steel, that is aluminium is added, aluminium or its different alloys are added, and it will act as a deoxidizer, means whichever airs air bubbles, or whichever air is there in that particular material, or here I have taken the example of the steel, it will remove that air. Okay, that whichever gas is there, gas get dissolved in the steel when that steel is in the molten form. At that time, if you add that aluminium, it will remove that gases, whichever gases are dissolving in that steel. That's why it is termed as the deoxidizer. Okay, then this aluminium and its different alloys can also be used for grain refinements of the coppers and its alloys like brasses. Okay, grain refinement in this sense, you can change its grain sizes from coarse grain, means it from larger grain size, you can modify it to the smaller grain size. And what will be the effect of this grain refinement? Due to this grain refinement, mechanical properties will get improved. Suppose you have decreased its grain size, then what will happen? Its tensile strength, its hardness, and its toughness will get improved. Means it due to this grain refinement, its mechanical properties will get improved. That's why we are using the aluminium for that purpose. Grain refinement is very necessary from transformation from coarse grain to the finer grains, means from larger grain size to the smaller grain size. To perform this, we are using this aluminium and its alloys, okay, for refinement of the coppers and different types of the brasses. Okay, to improve the mechanical properties, grain refinement is very necessary. So these are the properties of the aluminium, general characteristics or properties of the aluminium, and these properties will be there in its alloys also, and some properties will be modified, different alloying elements in it, depending on that, its properties may vary. Okay. And then we will move towards the next point. After this point, we will discuss about the its respective alloys. We will take some practical examples here. That is the aluminium and its aluminium and silicon alloys. Okay, in our syllabus we are having aluminium silicon alloys and aluminium magnesium alloys, aluminium copper alloys. After that, aluminium silicon and copper alloys. We will discuss it one by one. And before starting this, we will discuss about the some common applications of aluminium and its alloys. Now, these aluminium alloys, these are used for manufacturing of the different, you can say that utensils or different utensils we are using in the cooking, in our home as well as in the restaurants also. In short, you can mention the different cooking utensils. Then combs are there, then collar buttons, different kinds of the toasters, mixers, then electrical conductors, then food containers, then aluminium, some for manufacturing of the paints also it can be used, manufacturing of the name plates. Ashtrays, different kinds of the flower pots, different kinds of the coins, all these. Components which are used in the bicycles, then motorcycles, trucks, buses, then aeroplanes also, and in the different kinds of the marine applications also, we can use this aluminium and its different alloys. Then these aluminium and their alloys can be used for decoration purposes, because they are having very good corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance. This can be used for the decoration purpose. Then, as we have discussed that these are having very low ductile brittle transition temperature. These can be used for refrigeration and cryogenic services also. Then some more applications are there. That is, these are used for manufacturing of the magnets, permanent magnets are there. Then for manufacturing of the different space alloys and shape memory alloys are there that can be manufactured with the help of these aluminium and their alloys only. Then after discussing this, the next point we are going to discuss, it will be related to the aluminium and silicon alloys. Okay, please draw this equilibrium diagram. Write down the heading aluminium and silicon alloys, and please draw the equilibrium diagram. On y-axis, temperature will be there. On x-axis, weight percentage of silicon will be there. I will wait for 2 minutes here. After that, we will discuss related to this equilibrium diagram. After completing the drawing, please mention that in the chat box. I will wait for 2 minutes. Okay, if you are having any query up to this point that is related to the properties of the aluminium and their alloys, then it's different applications. Okay, if you are not having any query related to this application point also, then I will go to the its particular alloys, that is aluminium and silicon alloys. Okay, this one more, this some question may be there, if any question related to this shape memory, whether you are aware about this shape memory alloys, what are these shape memory alloys? Am I audible? Okay, we will move towards next. In short, I will tell you that what is these shape memory or space alloys. These space alloys are the specific alloys are there which are used for manufacturing of the different components which we are using in the aircrafts, or you can say that in the different missiles or rockets, to manufacture different components which are having or which are lighter in weight. That specific alloys will be termed as the space alloys. And these shape memory alloys are those alloys which when we are, you can say that in short, which when we are doing the cooling, or which when given, or in short you can say that which when used for very lower temperature, means we are just performing one cooling operation on it, then they will change their shape. Okay, according to our need, we can change their shape by doing the cooling of that particular alloy. And again, if you want to change its shape, then you can change its shape again by providing some heat also. Okay, means by doing the cooling or different cooling cycles, or by using different heating cycles, you can give the different shape and sizes as per your need. That kind of alloys will be termed as the shape memory alloys. Okay, in short, you can say that you can change their shapes depending on your need by doing the cooling operation on it, or by doing the heating operation on it. That alloys will be termed as the shape memory alloys. These space alloys are alloys which are used for manufacturing different components of missiles, rockets. That will be termed as the space alloys. The main property will be, and they will having very lightweight, and they will provide you better oxidation and corrosion resistance also. Then the next is the aluminium and silicon alloy. Now here, this is the equilibrium diagram. Now already, as I have mentioned here, it is eutectic transformation occurs at this point. Okay, please see it carefully. I'm highlighting it. At this point, eutectic transformation will occur. Eutectic transformation means this liquid will get transformed to form a mixture of two solids. This is alpha phase and the silicon. Separate silicon will be there. This mixture will be formed at this particular composition and temperature, and it will be 11.7% silicon and 577 degree Celsius temperature. Okay, now in some cases we are doing the modification. Okay, now here one term is there, modification of the aluminium and silicon alloys. Then what is the meaning of modification? Why this modification is done? These kind of questions are generally asked in the exam, theory exam also. And you can say that the objective questions may be asked in your competitive examination also. They will provide you options like aluminium silicon alloys, then copper zinc alloy, like this. They will provide you four options, and they will ask you on which alloys modification process is performed. Okay, now here modification process is generally performed on the aluminium silicon alloys, and here silicon percentage will be more than 8%. Silicon percentage will be more than 8%. And then why this it is necessary to perform this operation, that is the modification process is performed, because as you can see that at this particular point, 11.7%, eutectic transformation is occurring, means alloys having lesser composition than this, it will be hypoeutectic alloy, and alloys having more composition than this, it will be a hypereutectic alloy. Okay, at this particular point, eutectic transformation is occurring, 11.7% silicon. If composition is less than this, that alloy will be hypoeutectic alloy, and if composition is more than this, that will be hypereutectic alloy. Now, whenever alloy is having composition more than 11.7% silicon, then it will be a hypereutectic alloy. And for that hypereutectic alloy, you can see here clearly towards this right hand side of this diagram, silicon is formed before actually eutectic transformation, means pre-silicon or pre-phase formed here is, or you can say that pre-eutectic phase is silicon. Okay, before actual eutectic transformation, free silicon is formed here, and this free silicon, okay, What happens here due to the formation of this free silicon, the mechanical properties of these material will get affected, means its strength will get reduced. Due to the free silicon, it will increase the brittleness of the material. Okay, what will happen is mechanical properties will get deteriorated, you can say that in short word, due to the formation of this free silicon, or you can say that proeutectic silicon. And its mechanical properties like tensile strength, or you can say that its ductility or toughness, it will get decreased due to formation of this free silicon. Now here our aim is to avoid the formation of this free silicon. That's why we are performing the modification process here, and in this modification process we are adding the sodium in this alloy, and this sodium is added in this amount only, that is very small amount of sodium is added, ranging in between 0.005% to 0.015% only. Due to this, what will happen, modification will take place, means that eutectic transformation temperature as temperature will get reduced and its composition will get increased, as it is indicated here, that is when modification is done, then this eutectic transformation point, here I have shown it by the dotted line, due to the modification process, this eutectic transformation point will get shifted and temperature will fall here. From actual eutectic transformation temperature is 577, but due to modification process it will fall to 452 only. Okay, means at this point here, this is the modification or modified curve, and it will be having composition that is 12.6% silicon, and temperature will be 452. At this point now eutectic transformation will occur. Okay, due to this modification, what will happen, that eutectic transformation point will get shifted, means the temperature will get decreased and composition will get increased for occurrence of that eutectic transformation. Okay, and this modification is done by adding sodium in very small amount within the range 0.005 to 0.015%. Okay, so these are the aluminium and silicon alloys. Then in general, these aluminium silicon alloys are having very good corrosion resistance and oxidation resistance due to presence of this silicon only, and this silicon improves the corrosion resistance, oxidation resistance. Along with that, due to addition of the silicon, it improves its fluidity. Due to this fluidity, you can do the casting operation very easily on this type of alloys, that is on aluminium and silicon alloys. You can perform casting operations very easily due to addition of this silicon. Okay. Now in examination, question may be there related to the modification process, or they may ask you, explain this equilibrium diagram, then you have to draw this equilibrium diagram, then you have to explain related to the eutectic transformation composition and its temperature, then why we are doing the modification and what happens after the modification, and these are the general properties and how modification is done. Okay, then after this explanation, here I have taken some examples of the aluminium and silicon alloys. It is denoted by LM6. Okay, its name is LM6, and here its composition I have explained the properties, that it will be having excellent fluidity and shows very less shrinkage during the solidification, and better corrosion resistance and better oxidation resistance due to addition of the silicon. Then these are used as I have discussed that due to addition of silicon, its fluidity increases, and that's why you can perform casting operations very easily. Due to that, these are used for manufacturing of different automobile casting, such as water cooled manifolds, then jackets, motor housing, then different pump parts which are used in the chemicals and dye industries. All these are manufactured with these aluminium and silicon alloys. Okay, so this is the composition, properties and application, and explanation related to the equilibrium diagram for aluminium and silicon alloys. Then after this aluminium and silicon alloys, this is not they are not going to ask you the detailed question related to this aluminium, silicon and copper alloys, but I have taken few examples of that with their names LM2, LM24 and LM4. Along with that, I have written some their composition in the bracket. Silicon, copper and aluminium will be there. Aluminium will act as a base metal and silicon and copper will be alloying elements, and silicon will be the means principal alloying element or dominant alloying element will be there. Now these aluminium, silicon and copper alloys, these are used in manufacturing of different automobile components, like you can say that the pistons, you can say one common example, that is the pistons are manufactured with the help of this aluminium, silicon and copper alloys. Okay, now the next type will be in this is the aluminium and magnesium alloy. Now these aluminium and magnesium alloys in general, they are named as magnelium. They are named as magnelium. Now before going for actual composition, some properties are there. These are having very high resistance to the corrosion. They will provide you very good tensile strength, and in addition to this, they will provide you very good machinability due to addition of the magnesium here, and in some cases some smaller amount of the manganese may be there. Some two examples I have taken here, LM5 and LM10, these are their names and their composition will be like this. For LM5, 5% magnesium and 0.5% manganese, and remaining amount of aluminium will be there. And in LM10, 10% magnesium and remaining amount of aluminium will be there. Manganese is not present here. Okay, we have doubled the magnesium amount and manganese is eliminated in the LM10 as compared to LM5. Okay, why we are doing this modification? Because there is some difficulty, some kind of difficulty will be there while performing the casting operations on the LM5 due to presence of that manganese. That's why it is eliminated. And now on LM10, you can easily perform casting operations. Okay, now what are the applications of this aluminium and magnesium alloys? For this aluminium and magnesium alloys, commonly these are used for, you can say that in short, these are used in the marine application, then aircraft applications or different automobile applications. Then according to its composition, LM5, that is the aluminium and magnesium alloy with 5% magnesium, 0.5% manganese and remaining amount of aluminium, this LM5 alloy, it will be used for marine applications. Okay, different marine components that can be manufactured with the help of this magnelium, because they will be having very lighter weight and they will provide you higher resistance to the corrosion. Because in the marine applications, that equipment or whichever vehicle is there, it will be subjected to the corrosion due to the seawater. Okay, seawater is highly corrosive in nature, and to resist that, these magneliums are used. And generally LM5 is used, which will be consisting of magnesium and manganese also. Then LM10, that is the alloy of magnesium and aluminium, having 10% magnesium and a remaining amount of the aluminium. These are used for manufacturing of the different components which we are going to use in the aircraft industry, in the automobile industry, then different dairy equipments, and some different architectural equipments which are having some highly finished surface. These are also manufactured with the help of this magnelium. So this is the explanation related to the aluminium magnesium alloys, which are also known as the magnelium. In short, you can say that aluminium and magnesium alloys, alloys of the aluminium and magnesium. And these are used, this will provide you high corrosion resistance and high tensile strength. And due to this, these can be used for manufacturing of the different parts or different equipments which can be used in the marine applications, then which can be used for manufacturing of the different components which can be used in the aircrafts, automobile industry, and in the architectural work also. So this is the aluminium and magnesium alloy, also known as magnelium. Then the next is the aluminium and copper alloy. Now, aluminium and copper alloy. Here, I have taken few examples in the composition. In short, it is the alloy of the aluminium and copper. Aluminium will be base metal. Copper will be the alloying element. For example, LM11, it consists of 4.5% copper and a remaining amount of the aluminium. Now here, most commonly used or most commonly asked example, that is this question will be asked in the theory also, as far as your university examination is concerned, that is duralumin. You can say that this is having the, in short, you can say that it is alloy of aluminium and copper. And here, it will consist of 4.5% copper. And in this, 0.5% of magnesium and manganese is added, and remaining amount of aluminium will be there. Now, as here copper is there, as copper is present, you can say that it is having very good shock resistance. And due to magnesium and manganese, they will provide you tensile strength and hardness. Along with that, they will be having very good corrosion resistance also. They will be having very good corrosion resistance also. Now here, they will provide you very good tensile strength and hardness due to the precipitation hardening. Here, precipitation hardening will occur in the aluminium and copper alloys. This precipitation hardening is nothing but hardening will occur as time passes away. This is precipitation hardening process is having detailed explanation that we are going to discuss in the next lecture. Just try to remember that due to this precipitation hardening process, hardness will get improved. Strength and hardness will get improved. Now, these aluminium and copper alloys, they will provide you sufficient strength and hardness. Along with that, they will provide you moderate corrosion resistance and with very good shock resistance. Here, best property of this aluminium and copper alloy is very good shock resistance. Now, in which field these are used, very good due to this very good shock resistance and a very good strength and hardness, these are used in manufacturing of the different castings, and that castings can be used in the aircraft industry. In short, different parts or components that can be used in the airplanes or different aircraft equipments, that castings are manufactured with the help of this aluminium and copper alloys. And most commonly used is the duralumin or LM11 alloy. Okay, so in general, they are used for this. And then after this aluminium and copper alloys, the next alloy of aluminium is Y alloys. Okay. You can say that it also consists the copper, or this Y alloys may be considered as the alloy of the aluminium and copper also. Here, I have taken one example. These Y alloys are also termed as or known as LM14. LM14. Now, related to its composition, it consists of 4% copper, 2% nickel, 1.5% magnesium, and remaining amount will be of aluminium. I will repeat it. Y alloys, which are also known as LM14, it consists of 4% copper, 2% nickel, 1.5% magnesium, and remaining amount of aluminium. Now, these alloys will be having a very good corrosion resistance, and you can perform casting operations very easily on it. Now, which specific property is provided by these alloys, Y alloys? They will provide you very high strength and hardness at elevated temperatures also. Means at higher temperature ranges also, they will provide you very good strength. Means their strength is sustainable at the higher temperatures also. Then, wherever
large amount of heat is generated or wherever that component is subjected to the higher temperatures at that manufacturing of that particular components, these Y alloys are used, and due to this property means they will provide high strength and hardness at the higher temperatures or elevated temperatures. These are used in the manufacturing of the pistons and pistons in cylinder heads of diesel and high duty petrol engines. Okay, pistons and cylinder heads, because they will get subjected to the higher temperatures or elevated temperatures. That's why to sustain that, they will require a material which will sustain its strength and hardness at the higher temperatures. That's why we are using the Y alloys there. Y alloy is also known as LM14. It consists of copper, nickel, and magnesium, and base metal will be aluminum. Okay, so this is the Y alloys. Then after this Y alloys, the next alloy is RR350, or it is also known as Hinduminium. Okay, Hinduminium, like aluminium, it is termed as the Hinduminium. Now here you can see the composition again. It is the aluminium and copper alloy. Okay, all these, whichever we have discussed, that LM11, we have started from here. Okay, here LM11, duralumin, then this Y alloy, then this Hinduminium. All these three or four examples which I have taken, all these are aluminium and copper alloys. They may ask you anyone from this, either they will provide you direct name like Hinduminium, duralumin or Y alloy, or directly they will ask you aluminium and copper alloys with few examples and applications. Now this, as far as this Hinduminium is concerned, it is also known as RR350, and its composition will be like this: 5% of copper will be there, 1% of nickel, and remaining amount of aluminium, that is base metal aluminium, will be there, and some small amount of manganese, small amount of manganese, titanium, then cobalt, zircon, then niobium can be added, and it will be having, this alloy will be provide you very good. Okay, now this is having one similar characteristics which is present in the Y alloy, that is the, they will provide you very high strength at elevated temperatures or at higher temperature ranges also. Then they are having very good corrosion resistance, and they will provide you very good creep resistance also. Now due to this properties, that is very good corrosion resistance, very good creep resistance, and it will provide you all these properties at the higher temperature ranges also. And these Hinduminium or RR350, these can be used in the whichever engines which we are using in the airplanes or different aircraft industries engines that can be termed as aero engines. There we can use these Hinduminiums, and whichever applications are subjected to the higher temperature applications, that is above 300 degrees Celsius or approximately 300 to 350 degrees Celsius, if during that application temperature is up to 300 or 350 degrees Celsius, then these alloys can be used for manufacturing of that particular equipment of that or particular component. Okay, generally these are used in manufacturing of different kinds of the aero engines. Okay, so these are the Hinduminiums. So in this way, in this lecture, we have covered different aluminium. We have started with, I will take one review. Okay, we have started from here, aluminium, then aluminium and its alloys. We have discussed in this total lecture aluminium and its different alloys, and that we have started with different properties of the aluminiums. These properties will be there in the aluminium as well as their alloys also. Then after discussing these properties, we have discussed some common applications of this aluminium and their alloys. Then we have started some, taken few practical examples of this. In that, first we have discussed related to the aluminium and silicon alloys, then its equilibrium diagram, And along with that equilibrium diagram, we have discussed it, some common properties, then how modification process is done. First of all, we discussed the why modification process is required, then how it is done, and what changes will be there in that aluminium and silicon will occur due to this modification process. Then after this, we have discussed aluminium, silicon, and copper alloys. We have taken some common examples, LM2, LM24, and LM4. And its applications are, these are LM2, LM24, and LM4. These are used in the manufacturing of the pistons. Next, we have discussed aluminium and magnesium alloys, which are also known as magnelium. Here also, we have discussed related to LM5, LM10, and their composition, properties, and their applications. LM5 used for the marine applications. LM10 is used in the aircraft industry and automobile industry. And it will be, it can be also used in the architectural work, as it will provide you very attractive look. Then aluminium and copper alloys. In this aluminium and copper alloys, we have taken different examples that you can say that duralumine, then Y alloy, then hinduminium. These hinduminiums are used, hinduminiums and Y alloys, these are used means for the applications which are subjected to the higher temperature ranges. These Y alloys are used for manufacturing of pistons and cylinder heads of diesel and high duty petrol engines. And these hinduminiums are used in the manufacturing of aero engines, or some applications which are performed at the higher temperature ranges up to 300 degrees Celsius or 350 degrees Celsius. Okay, in this way we have completed on this part, that is aluminium and aluminium alloys. In next lecture, we are going to deal with the what is the meaning of precipitation hardening or age hardening, what are the different steps involved in it, then its specific examples, then factors affecting that we are going to discuss in the next lecture. Okay, in this lecture we have completed this part, aluminium and its alloys. Then we have discussed, we will stop here actually. Okay, this part is over, I think, as far as this aluminium alloys are concerned. This part is over. Only one method is there, that is precipitation hardening. That I will take in the separate lecture. In next lecture, I will complete it. That process is very important. One compulsory question will be on it. And whichever part we have discussed today, out of this, I think we have studied some 4 or 5 alloys here. Okay, aluminium silicon alloys, aluminium silicon and copper, aluminium magnesium, and aluminium copper. In aluminium copper, duralumine, Y alloy, and hinduminium, all these are aluminium copper alloys. Out of these 5 or 6 alloys, 2 alloys they will ask related to composition properties and applications you have to write. Okay. Okay. Thank you for attending the lecture. I will stop the recording.